Wat als Columbus niet Amerika had ontdekt, maar de Inca's Europa? Dat is precies wat er gebeurt in het boek Beschavingen van Laurent Binet. Hij zet de wereldgeschiedenis totaal op zijn kop. Laurent Binet, de Franse auteur van de gigantische bestseller, ik heb hem hier ergens liggen, Ha 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 Ha, waarvan alleen al in Nederland 175.000 exemplaren werden verkocht. En de VPRO maakte ook een serie over hem, over dit boek. Ja, Laurent, welcome. We're going to do this interview in English. First of all, the book Beschavingen. What's it in French? Say it again.
Civilisation.
Civilisation. Europe is being conquered by the Incas from Latin America. So not Columbus conquering Latin America. What does this Europe you describe in your book look like?
Well, first, the main religion becomes the religion of the sun, because it was the religion of the Incas. Mm-hmm. But also what would be interesting in that case, I think, is that time is the beginning of capitalism in Europe, you know. But it would, if Incas they came with a totally different system, mm-hmm. more socialist actually, mm-hmm. more with an economy more planified, you know, they would squeeze the growing of capitalism. So the face of Europe would be very, very different.
Are you comfortable? Do you want to put your chair closer to the table? Because we had to sit down very quickly. Yeah, are you comfortable now? So there, we would be worshipping the sun. There would be temples everywhere in Europe.
Temples of the sun, yeah.
Yeah. And would it also be a better Europe?
Well, I don't know, actually. It would be different, you know, with some things better, things worse, but...
For example?
Well, I mean, what would be better, I think, would be that they had a way to share the
resources.
The resources, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. According to the needs of communities, collectivities, you know. Mm-hmm. So, in a way, I think it would be fair. Mm-hmm. Then, well, I mean, they were practicing polygamy, so that's something else, you know.
It's not a problem. Well,
so it would be just different, yeah.
Okay, you also, it's also very funny, the book. I found it also quite funny. I want to give an example, because you write about the laws in Inca Europe. There's one law: the virgin conception of the false messiah Jesus is nonsense, probably made up to cover up the pregnancy of Maria, because her husband, Joseph, was an old, gray, impotent man. That's what you're saying about Jesus. And the true Jerusalem is not Jerusalem, the religious center, but it's Cusco in Peru. Because you're also mocking us, right?
Well, I mean, I think what was interesting is, if you see the world through Inca's eyes, mm-hmm. then it's... Many things are different, you know, and it's always, I think, stimulating to watch yourself, to watch your own world with foreign eyes, you know. Mm-hmm. So just, and especially about religion, I think every religion, if you watch it from outside, it looks like a lot of superstition, a lot mm-hmm. of strange customs, mm-hmm. and in a way, it looks always funny, you know.
Mm-hmm. But is it an anti-religious book? Because it seems to me, because you talk about the nailed God, this is Jesus on the cross, the worshiping of the nailed God, you mock it also. Is it like, is it an anti-Christian, anti-religious book?
Not especially anti-Christian, you know, but I think, I mean, it's always good, better to have a kind of anthropological side to religion, you know, because then you it helps not to be too fanatical, you know. Uh-huh. Like, I think, like, just you've got your own God, but once there is many hundreds of
gods,
then I think you can relax, because there is very little chance that your God is the good one.
The best one. There is a painting in the beginning and at the end of the book. It's the same painting. I think we can see it here. There's an Indian This is called, he's called Atahualpa. He's like the main character of the book. He's the one who conquers Europe, right?
Yeah.
Why did you choose this painting? What does it illustrate?
Well, this is a central scene of the all, one famous scene of the Spanish conquest, you know, because this is Pizarro asking for a meeting with the great emperor Atahualpa, mm-hmm. and making up a trap, you know, waiting for him and catching him mm. and taking the emperor as a hostage. So the Spanish, they were just 200 facing an empire of millions of people, and so they had no chance. But once Pizarro could grab Atahualpa, then and having Atahualpa as an hostage, then the balance of the chances.
So the few Spanish against the thousands of Incas, this is what really happened.
Yeah, yeah. But in twice Cortés and Pizarro.
Yeah, and you in your book you turn it around.
Yeah, yeah.
Because this is what Atahualpa does.
Yeah.
With
Charles the
With Charles the Fifth. I heard actually that this is going to that there's serious talks. That there's going to be a TV series about this book, right? Is that true?
I mean, I'm starting to working on the script, and it should be a co-production between France and the US.
So there's a real possibility this is going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
In an interview in the French newspaper Le Monde, you mentioned Quentin Tarantino. Because of the satisfaction of taking revenge in films. He was having Hitler killed in the movie Inglourious Basterds, Sharon Tate not being murdered in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. This is also something you do. There's a big similarity between what you do in your book and what Quentin Tarantino does. Are you trying to rewrite the history or are you trying to improve it?
I don't know. I mean, I definitely rewrite it because I know you can't remake it.
No,
it's a kind of either him or what I do. It's a kind of fantasy, you know, like a kind of fantasy catharsis. Uh-huh. And with Inglourious Bastard or with my book, the common idea is like to give a chance to those who lost, you know, and to a kind of revenge.
Revenge.
Some way, yeah. There is something with the revenge, you know. So I gave the revenge to the Indians and to Atahualpa.
Yeah, you have Columbus being killed.
Yeah, well,
I did enjoy reading it.
Because I think it's something like, you know, it's something like with. It's a lesson from Stephen King, you mm-hmm. know, like if you can kill a character, kill him. And so this is the lesson of Game of Thrones, of course. They remembered very well this
the
lesson.
Series, yeah.
And what was funny with my alternative history is mm-hmm. you are not supposed to be able to kill historical characters, you know.
Like Columbus or Charles the Great.
But with Uchronia, with alternative history, you can, so the pleasure is even bigger, I think.
Yeah, it's a pleasure writing it, it's a pleasure reading it, but can we also learn something from it?
Well, I hope you can. I mean, like, it's always very stimulating, like, to that what if question, you know, mm-hmm. because what if little change somewhere, you know, mm-hmm. would mm-hmm. have changed all the world history. And mm-hmm. if you do it well, if you go step by step with a kind of logic, you mm-hmm. realize that, yes, I mean, history is what it is, you know, but you wouldn't have needed a lot to make it completely different, you know, in my book, like few Vikings, they go south instead of going back east, mm-hmm. and all the world would have been changed.
Yeah, because yeah, it only takes one ship with some Vikings going south, and then we would have the people in Latin America would have been immune to all these diseases, right? Yeah, that's what you do.
And we would,
that's what you do in the book.
And we would speak Quechua right now.
Yeah. You like to make fun of the powerful people in the world. That's what you did with the Nazis in Ha 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 Ha. Then the French intellectuals in your second book. And now us Europeans. Who's next?
Well, I don't know, but I have to say I don't consider the French theory and the philosophers from the 80s the same way as I consider Nazis.
Okay, okay. But who's next? Are you thinking of
no,
something?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. I have no plans. My next book will be a dictionary about tennis, you know, so it will be completely different.
Something completely different. Laurent, thank you so much. And I hope it's going to be a big series.